Hello. When Greg Curno asked me to come and speak, he told me it could be serious or humorous, or I could say whatever I wanted to say. And he told me to talk about something that was of current interest to me. So I'd like to begin by saying that what happened to me 3 days ago, I want to talk about. I went to a party, and at the party, I met a girl. This girl had taken LSD about an hour before that, and we communicated non-verbally. We communicated just simply through being together. She did not allow words to interfere with awareness of reality.
I've done that too, girl. On two occasions.
And the evening ended up by, she gave me a flower, a rose. I think this was very beautiful. Now, what I... The subject of my talk is silence. I would like to speak to you about the nonverbal. I had a friend who said he is a person who could see on his tombstone written the words, "Here is a man who spent his life talking about the nonverbal." He was very good at theorizing, at realizing the value of immediate awareness of reality, and without allowing words to get in between him and reality. Now, what I'm saying has been said before by the anonymous writers of the Upanishads, by the Buddha, by Jesus, by the Sufi mystics, by Suzuki, Alan Watts, Walt Whitman, and so on. The message has been heard at all times and all places. It's what Aldous Huxley has called the perennial philosophy. The message is extremely simple. It is so simple that most people cannot comprehend it. Because of the brainwashing and hypnosis of society, it is the hardest thing in the world for most people to be simple and to allow themselves to be directly aware of reality. Most people are either verbalizing, talking to somebody else, or talking to themselves about reality. They allow the words to get between themselves and the reality it represents. Artists do the same thing, only they do it with painting. The important thing is direct awareness of the reality, of the here and now. Now, the hardest thing in the world is for people to be simple. This depends on purity of heart. And Jesus had said, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." There is no other way of seeing God. Children are pure in heart. And Jesus said, "Except ye become as a little child, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven." This purity of heart is the understanding and awareness of immediate reality, being able to sense one's body and the world around oneself, to sense the beauty of nature and not be constantly verbalizing about the world. I think the greatest books, like the greatest poems, are those that point the way to the mystery of being. To do this, one needs to be open to experience. The greatest books, the greatest poems, point the way to silence. In the heart of everything is silence. And in the deepest heart of our being is this silence, which is the silence, the mystery of being. You've heard the expression, The syllables om, A-U-M. A chant. People chant this over and over to attain enlightenment. This is in the Hindu tradition. Before the beginning of the om and after the end of the word is the silence. This is the silence of the world of reality as we see it, without structuring reality by talking about it. Most of the time our words get between ourselves and the reality. Now I want to close by reading something to you from a book by Ronald Lang called The Politics of Experience. He is a psychiatrist, and this is the end of his book, the last two paragraphs. Can you hear me all right, everybody? Okay. After I'm finished, you may ask me any questions. I have seen the bird of paradise. She has spread herself before me. Pardon? I have seen the bird of paradise. She has spread herself before me, and I shall never be the same again. There is nothing to be afraid of. Nothing. Exactly. The life I am trying to grasp is the me that is trying to grasp it. There is really nothing more to say when we come back to that beginning of all beginnings. That is nothing at all. Only when you begin to lose that Alpha and Omega do you want to start to talk and to write. And then there is no end to it. Words, words, words. At best and most, they are perhaps in memoriam. Evocations, conjurations, incantations, emanations, shimmering iridescent flares in the sky of darkness. A just, still feasible tact. Indiscretions, perhaps forgivable. City lights at night from the air, receding like these words. Atoms, each containing its own world and every other world, each a fuse to set you off. If I could turn you on, if I could drive you out of your wretched mind, if I could tell you, I would let you know. In conclusion, Buddha's most important sermon was not the various things that he said to his disciples, not his spoken words. At the end of his greatest sermon, Buddha stood before his audience and simply showed his disciples a flower. This is the rose the girl gave to me the other night. A flower. When Buddha gave the flower, what he was saying silently is that the important thing is the moment, the here and now, the reality that exists here. This is where the kingdom of heaven is, on this earth now. And one needs to be aware of the reality, and as I say, not allow the words to get in between man and the world. Words are useful, words need to be used, but we need to get beyond words. As Ludwig Wittgenstein said at the end of his Tractatus, whereof one cannot speak, thereof one must remain silent. Remain silent. The last word, silence, and then the reality.